My presentation today will be about conformity assessment and what is the relation actually with artificial intelligence. And I will take as a perspective, of course, a proposal for a law, because I'm a lawyer and I work in this field quite some time now. And I'm going to look at the AI proposal for AI regulation. I should already say that this talk is very well connected to the previous two TISIC talks of my colleagues, Professor Ronald Leines, who gave an introduction of the proposal for the Act, and Associate Professor Esther Kai-Mollen, who introduced the concepts of trust and trustworthiness in AI. But first things first, where is the conformity assessment in the first place? Conformity assessment is, to put it simply, a demonstration that specified requirements are fulfilled or not. So we need an object to be assessed. This could be a product, a process, a system, or a service, organization, or a combination of those. We need pre-specified requirements. Those can be found in technical standards, like think of ISO or the EN, the European standards from CEN and CENELEC, or ETSI. These are the European standards organizations. The requirements can also be found in legislation. And this is what I'm going to refer to in this presentation. I should also mention that things can become a bit more complicated, but we will not go so much into detail today because there are technical standards that are based in the legislation and there are all kinds of legal effects. When it comes to conformity assessment, it's very important to remember that there are three types of conformity assessment. You have first-party conformity assessment. This means that, let's say, a manufacturer of a product, and I'm going to refer to products from now on because it's more simple. A manufacturer of a product does the assessment himself on whether, for instance, the product is going to be, before being placed in the market, is going to be safe or fulfilling some other requirements that are prescribed in the law or a standard. Second party conformity assessment is when we have, let's say, a business partner or an end user that wants to use a facial recognition system. This could be the police, for example, and they want to be sure that this facial recognition system is not going to be discriminatory or is going to fulfill some requirements. And then we have third-party conformity assessment. This is from third-party organizations and that have been found to be expert in a field and also have integrity and that they are independent from the product manufacturer. So first-party and third-party conformity assessment are very relevant for the proposal for the regulation that I'm referring to today. But that's a spoiler. But what does this have to do with actually public interest and public goals? Well, actually, the regulator, the public regulator, the lawmakers in the European Union and elsewhere, but I focus on the EU today, they have actually have been harvesting and relying quite a lot on this private law activity, because conformity assessment is essentially done by private organizations, private bodies. And they have been relying on the expertise of these private experts for quite some time now. And I'm already referring to the new approach, which actually dates back from the 80s and it's not so new anymore, and the relevant new legislative framework, as it is called. So what has been happening for quite some time now is that the EU lawmakers have been relying on the private lawmakers or private regulators to draft the nitty-gritty details of the requirements of what is, for example, a safe toy, or a product that fulfills some health requirements or that is friendly to the environment. And what this entails in practice is that the law provides only the essential, as we call them, requirements. So the law says that a product needs to be safe before being placed in the market. And then technical standards organizations and conformity assessment bodies work together with the Commission and other public regulators to actually develop the standards that specify what it means for a product, for a toy, for example, to be safe for a kid of 0 to 2 years old. So what does toy safety and all these issues have to do with artificial intelligence? So as mentioned also by my colleagues in the previous talks, in April this year, so a couple of months ago, the Commission published this proposal for AI regulation. And while I wouldn't have expected, thinking about it some years ago, oh, there's the Commission proposing a regulation for AI, what is this going to be about? Well, it did happen that one big part of this regulation is about conformity assessment. And conformity assessment has a very central role in this regulation. It concerns ex-ante rules, so before actually a product, an AI system is placed in the market, but also what we call as ex-post enforcement. This essentially means that there are some measures in place to monitor that an AI system that is placed in the market continues to fulfill certain legal requirements. And those requirements are actually mandatory requirements that are prescribed in the text of the proposal. And they concern a range of things, such as transparency, but also avoiding the discriminatory effects from the use of the AI system and other relevant things. So what happens is that, let's say, a manufacturer or a designer of an AI system needs to fulfill these requirements, the legal requirements, but they also need to make sure that this is a process that is verified, so that is subject to conformity assessment, so what I referred to before. The AI regulation proposal adopts a risk-based approach, and this is a quite an important notion also to that is connected to conformity assessment. So the proposal actually qualifies three types of risk. What it calls as an acceptable risk, and is connected to prohibited uses of AI systems, and this has nothing to do with conformity assessment. Then AI systems that are presenting high risk for the safety and the fundamental rights of individuals, and these are very well connected to this talk about conformity assessment, because conformity assessment concerns these types of systems. And then low risk AI systems that are mostly connected to voluntary measures like codes of conduct. And those what actually is a high risk or an acceptable risk are determined on the basis of several factors like the sector or taking account the impact on the rights and safety of individuals. Further, there are two categories of high risk AI systems. And first, the regulation, the proposal for the regulation distinguishes one category of AI systems that are safety components of products. These kind of systems, they have to be subject to third-party conformity assessment. So what I said before, they have to be assessed by a third private organization, but independent from the manufacturer, the producer of the AI system. Then we also have what is called as standalone AI systems. And this is where it becomes more tricky, because actually these are systems that have implications on fundamental rights of individuals. I think, for example, what I said before, the system of live facial recognition system used for law enforcement purposes by the police, which can turn out to be discriminatory if the proper requirements are not met. So these are systems that have high risk for not safety, which is the first category, but for fundamental rights of individuals. And what the regulation, the proposal for the regulation does is that it mostly connects these kind of systems to self-assessment, so that the manufacturer himself is going to assess whether the product is fulfilling some requirements, legal requirements, and is okay to be placed in the market. So this is how the process looks like in a simplified manner. If you want a more complicated graph, Ronald Lanes has posted on his Twitter account this marvelous, very, very complicated graph. So I thought not to scare you today, but if you want more information, more detail, you can always refer to that graph. So this is what happens in practice, or if adopted, actually, if the regulation is adopted as proposed. The provider of the high-risk AI system will go through either the third-party conformity assessment or a self-assessment. There will be an assessor. This is an internal auditor in the case of self-assessment, or an external person. Will assess whether the requirements, the legal requirements, are fulfilled, and then will receive a C marking, which means that it's okay to be placed in the market, or it needs to go through some more fine-tuning. Using this system in general technical standards and conformity assessment can help organizations comply with legal requirements. It provides tools and processes, risk assessment methodologies, but even common vocabularies for the expert engineers to communicate and talk to each other, and meaning actually the same thing. And then conformity assessment offers also an assurance to organizations that some external, in the case of third-party conformity assessment, some external person has actually confirmed that they are fulfilling the requirements. And it also, of course, offers some information to consumers about the qualities of the AI system, without this, of course, being sufficient and on its own being enough for consumers to say that they are completely informed. But that's for another discussion. And then it also provides, and this is what I discussed also in my PhD dissertation, which I defended a couple of weeks ago, they also provide meta rules. So they make sure that the rules that apply in these AI systems and those very fast developing fields are actually up to date with the latest state-of-the-art technology. But of course, there are also important legitimacy issues, and it's no secret that these are private organizations, and they are not following what we know as democratic legitimacy procedures. So not all members have an equal say. We're not sure. It's not so open and transparent always who sits around the table to make standards. There are also some issues of judicial accountability. So can a certification body or a standardization body be held liable for defective products that are based on their standards? And of course, independence and conflict of interest are also a tricky area when we're talking about private regulations, because in the end of the day, conformity assessment bodies are being paid by the manufacturer. Okay. And because I see I'm running out of time, I will pose these open questions, and I'm actually looking forward to getting your input and brainstorming on answers to these questions. One open question is, how suitable is this whole system of product conformity assessment approach? How can we see an AI system that proposes high risks to fundamental rights as a product? What are we missing out where it's not in the picture? How reliable can self-assessment be for these high-risk AI systems? And then, of course, there are issues of assessment methodology. Part of it is that the assessment will take place on the basis of the intended use of the product and not the actual use of the product. So how can we be sure that despite any measures for market post-market surveillance, those rules will be for sure implemented and followed. So this is from my side. Thank you very much for your attention,